Westgate. How's everybody doing? Doing good? Yeah? Let's stand up, let's worship together. Come on.
Lift your head, weary sinner. The river's just ahead. Down the path of forgiveness, salvation's waiting there. You built a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Love is here to lift you up, it's here to lift you high. If you're lost and wondering, come stumbling in like the prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. Unspeakable things you've done. Fix your eyes on the mountain. Let the past be dead and gone.
Come all you saints and sinners, you can't outrun God.
Oh no!
Whatever you've done can overcome the power of the blood. If you're lost and wandering, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide. If you're lost and wrecked again, come stumbling in like a prodigal child. See the walls start crumbling, let the gates of glory open wide.
God is for you and he loves you so much. Can I get an amen if you've experienced his freedom? Yes, if you know Jesus, that's right. Let's continue worshiping together, singing of his great love for us.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's our God children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. of the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Blood praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this.
That's right.
It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory. Hallelujah, He reigns.
And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard.
Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word.
Yeah!
When all God's children sing and glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. He reigns. All God's children sing and glory. It's all God's people singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns.
Hey.
Hey, good morning, church family. You may be seated. It is good to be here and worshiping together this morning. We've got such a great morning planned. And again, I want to just pause and welcome those of you that may be guests here with us today. My name is Rob Zimmerman. I'm the lead pastor here at Westgate. And we are just thrilled that you've chosen to worship with us today as well. Welcome to those of you who are at home worshiping online. We're thankful that you faithfully join us each and every week. As we get our service started this morning, just a couple of quick things. One, I want to encourage you, especially if you're a guest, to take a moment to fill out the connection card that you'll find in the pew in front of you. It's a great way to get connected here at the church, and we would love for you at the end of the service just to take that out to the main entrance where we have our guest center and a couple of hosts that would love to answer questions you might have about the church. And we have a small gift of a journal that we would love to give you just as a way to say thank you for being here with us today. As well, those of you that are at home online, you can see that there is underneath the live stream a button that you can push and that you can also fill out a connection card online. We'd just love to know that you're here and worshiping with us today. We have a lot of things that are happening in our service this morning. Many of you know that have been here, and for those of you that are guests, it'd be good to know that Pastor Glenn and Sheila Lewis, this is going to be their last Sunday with us, have been here for 12 years serving faithfully, and yes, please. We are so thankful, and we're going to take some time at the close of our service today just to talk a little bit about their ministry with us, but Glenn is also going to be sharing with us from God's Word, and we're very excited to hear that this morning. One thing I do want to let you know at the close of our service today as well, we will have a reception with Glenn and Sheila over in our gymnasium that is off to my left, your right, and as you're heading over there at the close of the service, there's some cake and punch, opportunity to connect again with Glenn and Sheila, but we also in the east entrance have a photo booth that is set up. We would love for you and your family to take a photo, and then there is a table, and the photo will produce immediately, and there is also a place to write a note, just a special note of gratitude and thanks to Glenn and Sheila for their ministry here. So please be sure to stop by and do that as a special gift to them. And now we're going to continue worshiping together this morning. The reason that we're here is to give glory and honor to Jesus' name. So would you bow your heads and pray with me as we continue in worship? Lord, we thank you so much just for your goodness in each of our lives. And this morning we acknowledge, God, that there are times when we walk into your house where we come in with many different things on our hearts and minds. Sometimes we carry burdens. Sometimes we're just carrying the schedule that comes after church is over and the many things we're going to run into. And we confess that there are times when we come in and we just are not, our hearts aren't ready to worship. And so, God, we pause this morning. We breathe and we exhale and we cast our eyes to you. And we say, God, we've chosen to be here this morning because we want to ascribe worth and value to you. We want to meet with you. We want to worship you. And most importantly, God, we want to hear from you. And so, Lord, we pray that you would speak to us through your word, through the music this morning, and that you would receive glory and honor as this church family gathers together in your name to worship you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You are all we need. that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ. Silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the
thank you for this morning. Thank you for being our hope. In a current world that feels hopeless lots of the time, we thank you for that hope that you are, and we pray that everybody will find it. Help us to continue to do your work. Be with Glenn as he delivers his message this morning, and use him to speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Doug. I just want to thank the worship team. A lot of people will say things about them. But I don't think we understand how much work goes into this. Not only do they practice together, they come early, they have practices that are stay late, and then they practice themselves, by themselves, a lot at home. And we don't appreciate, and the tech team as well, how much time they put in so that we can praise God together with them. So let's hear a shout out for our worship team. And one more thing about the worship team, a lot of times they'll ask us what songs we'd like to have played. And a lot of times, I don't know, I just say, well, you guys choose. And Adam and his team listen to the Holy Spirit, because every single time, not once in a while, every single time, the songs they choose are chosen by the Holy Spirit through them, because they fit the sermon perfectly, just like the songs we heard this morning. So I praise God for our worship team. When we were in seminary, we studied a lot of noble things. We studied theology. We studied how to prepare and how to deliver a sermon, different ways to lead a church. But we also learned some stuff that wasn't quite so noble, some of the everyday, day-to-day stuff that goes on in a church. And one of those things was advice on how to leave a church. As a pastor, no matter what decisions you make, there's always going to be someone in the congregation who thinks you're wrong. It's tough being a pastor, and it's tough being a lead pastor. And because of that, sometimes a pastor can kind of leave on a sour note. In fact, there can be even bitterness between a pastor and the congregation. So the advice our professors gave us was this: don't ever use your final sermon as a chance to say all the things you always wanted to say but never did. But in spite of that device, that's exactly what I'm going to do today. I'm going to say a bunch of things that I've always wanted to say, but we never really had the right time to say it. I'm going to do it biblically, so don't worry. And what I mean is, I'm going to tell you something Paul told one of his churches that he was involved with somewhere between 60 and 70 AD. And even though those thoughts are 2,000 years old, they work. Not only for the church in Colossae in 63 AD, but also for Westgate Chapel in 2021. So as Pastor Mike would say, let's dive in. Open your Bibles, or your devices, or whatever you're using, to Colossians chapter 1, and we're going to focus on verses 1 to 14. We'll start off by reading Paul. We're just going to read the first section first. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ who are at Westgate Chapel. Colossae. Grace to you and peace from God our Father. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. And the words I want us to look at out of this little section are saints and faithful in verse 2, and then faith in verse 4. So let's start and look at the word saints. You are saints. And what that means is you have been set apart from the rest of the world, and you belong to God. You are his chosen people. He has adopted you into his family. You are his children. We generally think of a saint as a person who has this really strong connection to God, or else has done some incredible work for the good of mankind. But in reality, a saint is anyone who has put their faith in Jesus Christ. The Catholic Church has done us a kind of a disservice by reserving sainthood only for a select group of people. We are all saints. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, well, that's not me. I'm no saint. But you are. Are you always going to look like a saint? No. Will you always behave like a saint? No. But if you are in Christ, you will be moving in that direction. And as a church, As Westgate Chapel, you will be moving in that direction because you are set apart. You are saints. And I have to say that not only are you saints from a theological sense, but you're also saints in the Catholic sense. You have acted like saints to my wife and to me. You've accepted this Easterner from New York City and this Southern Virginia girl into your Midwestern culture. You've made us feel not only a part of your body, but as also a part of your community. And what's even more impressive is you made a guy from California your lead pastor. You are saints. The next word I want to look at, and we're going to come back to the word saints because it's important. It's very, very important, and you'll see why when we get to this later on in the sermon. Next word I want to look at is faith. The context is Paul is thanking God for the faith the Colossian church has. And when we think of faith, we usually think of it in religious terms. What is your faith? Well, I'm a Buddhist, I'm a Catholic, I'm a Protestant, whatever it is. But faith is far more than just religion. We have faith in a lot of things. And as we look at our faith in general, I think it's going to help us understand our faith in God a little bit better. First of all, faith is valid because of what we put our faith in. It's not just having faith that's important, it's also the object of our faith or what we are putting our faith in that is important. For example, we have faith in the atmosphere. We believe that when we take a breath, oxygen is going to fill our lungs and we will continue to live. My faith in the atmosphere is valid because the oxygen is there. It's a valid faith. And I know it's true based on my past experience. For 70 years, I've been believing this, I've been breathing this oxygen, and I'm still alive. If, however, I were to go to the moon, and I had total faith in the moon's atmosphere, that it could sustain my need for oxygen, if I tried to breathe, took my space helmet off and tried to breathe, no matter how strong my faith was, I'd die. So faith is very important, but the object of my faith is even more important. Another example, when we're driving our car on the roads and highways around here, we have tremendous faith in the other drivers that they're going to obey the rules of the road. If they have a red light, they're going to stop. When I'm driving down Central Avenue out towards Swanton, these massive steel trucks, and any of you who drove here or not, they've seen them, these massive steel trucks come down the other direction, and I have an incredible amount of faith that they're going to stay in their lane. My faith is valid because history has shown that almost 100% of the time, they do stay in their lane. Now, I think we all understand that type of faith. It's practical, it's concrete. It's the kind of faith we can touch, we can feel, we can see. But the faith Paul is talking about is a little bit different here because it's faith in Jesus Christ. And what makes this kind of faith different is Jesus is not physically with us. He's not driving a truck. We cannot reach out and touch him. What Paul is talking about here is a spiritual faith. We connect with him not on an asphalt highway. We connect with him spirit to spirit. It is a spiritual relationship, our spirit connecting to his spirit. But even though it's not like the faith I put in that truck driver, it is valid because of some very concrete, real, physical evidence. It's not just a blind faith. Jesus really does exist. He really did have a mom named Mary, a dad named Joseph. He really did have 12 disciples. He really did die a gruesome death, and he really did, most importantly, rise from the dead. We don't have time to go into all the reasons why we believe that here at Westgate, but that is what our faith is all about. It is faith in a real person. It is what makes our faith valid. When Jesus was asked by Thomas to explain the way they were supposed to go, Jesus told them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He didn't say this list of rules and laws are the way. He didn't say these religious experiences are the way. He didn't say these rites and rituals are the way. He said, I am the way. Paul is talking about faith in a living person, and that person is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the object of our faith, and we can have complete trust and confidence in him because he did what he said he was going to do. He rose from the dead. The object of our faith is Jesus, and that's what makes our faith valid. When people hear about Westgate Chapel, the most important thing they can hear is that we as a church have put our faith in Jesus Christ. It has been that way from the time this started in the tent in West Toledo. It's that way today, and it will be that way as long as Pastor Rob and his staff are here, and hopefully beyond. You'll hear it from the preachers who preach in this pulpit. You'll hear it from Marlena and Renee and Deneen in children's ministry. You'll hear it from Dan in middle school ministries. You'll hear it from Steve in high school ministries. You'll hear it from Mike in adult ministries. You'll hear it from Randy in the care ministry. You'll hear it from Juliana. She leads us outside these walls and into our communities and our world. You'll hear it every time Adam and Heidi and our worship team step on this stage to lead us to the throne of God. You'll hear it from Dave and Rob as they continue to lead us into the future. You'll hear it from our elders and our deacons and our deaconesses and our trustees. Westgate Chapel is a church that has put its faith in Jesus Christ, and don't you ever, ever forget it. We give thanks to God, the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. And that's what Westgate Chapel is all about. That is what you are all about. The faith of Westgate Chapel is valid because the object of its faith is Jesus Christ, who is the way, the truth, and the life. But there are other things about Westgate that Paul gives thanks for. I mentioned the word faithful from verse 2, and I want to go back to that. When we talk about faith, we're talking about our attitudes towards Christ. We're talking about our posture, what we think about him and what he is doing in our lives. But when Paul uses the term faithful brethren in verse 2, he's talking about the way faith in Jesus works itself out and how we live our lives. As James clearly points out in his letter to all Christians, faith without works is dead. If you truly have faith in Jesus Christ, you will live like him. His Spirit who lives in you will change you and show himself through you. You won't be perfect, and you're never going to be, but you will be moving in that direction. Something you need to do every so often is take a look or an inventory of your life. Look back at your life 2 years ago, 5 years ago. Be honest with yourself. Have you grown in your relationship with Jesus? Is the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control stronger in your life now than it was 2 years ago, 5 years ago? As the care pastor, I have had a bird's eye view of how this church is becoming more faithful. This church is faithful to Jesus Christ in a lot of different ways. Do we get it right every time? No. Are we where we want to be in every situation? No. But we are moving in the right direction. Pastor Rob and the rest of the preaching staff have been urging us in this direction. You've heard it over and over again. It's the power of Jesus in us that spills out of our lives into the lives in our church and in those and in our community. And it's happening. Again, do we get it right every time? No, but we're moving in that direction. Now, how do I know this? Well, Paul tells us. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. Now, here it is. And the love which you have for all the saints. One of the most obvious ways your faithfulness to God shows itself is in your own love for your brothers and sisters here at Westgate Chapel and in the churches around our community. In all our ministries, from little tykes all the way up to teenagers, Westgate is more and more becoming a church that cares for its congregation. Many of you have been involved with Westgate Cares. You've cleaned gutters, you've raked leaves, you've built ramps, you've fixed doors, you've trimmed hedges, you've chopped wood, you've installed cabinets, you've helped people pack and move. Our deacons have used a benevolence fund to help people in our congregation get through emergencies, pay hospital bills, keep food on the table, stay out of bankruptcy, keep their homes. Our deaconesses have cooked meals for families in mourning. They've kept in touch with those in our congregation who can't get out. They call. They send cards. They start food trains for those who temporarily can't cook because of some sort of emergency situation. Our youth ministries have created opportunities for our kids to serve in our neighborhoods and with our sister churches. They've done community projects. They've served at that neighborhood church. They've done mission trips. They're serving needs in and outside of Toledo. Then there are those of you who volunteer here at the church. You've helped in the church building and the grounds. You've taken care of our children. You've taught our students. You've taught our adults. You've been a part of the worship team. You've volunteered behind the scenes with preparation and cleanup of various events at the church. You're an elder. You're a deacon. You're a deaconess. You're a trustee. And then there are all those things you do for each other that nobody else knows about. You take time to pray with people in need. You call and you visit folks who are struggling. You see someone looking discouraged, and you take the time to stop and ask, how are you really doing? There are dozens of things you do every day for each other with no prompting from the church leadership. And those are expressions of your faithfulness to Jesus Christ. By being faithful to Jesus, you're expressing his love to each other. All these things are things you are doing in service to one another, and they express the love you have for the saints, for each other. Westgate Chapel has and continues to put its faith in Jesus, and it shows in how we love each other. Do we get it right every time? No, but we're moving in the right direction as our faith grows. But there's another aspect to why we are who we are in Christ. There's another motivation that drives us to do what we do. There's another reason that we love each other. Our motivation also, it comes from faith, but it also comes from our hope. Look at verses 4 and 5. That love you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Well, what's that all about? What hope are we talking about? Well, let's take a look at the word hope. We're actually going to look at the word faith again, but you'll see why. We might be tempted to think or feel that our faith should be enough for us to be who God wants us to be and to do what God wants us to do. After all, it's our faith in Jesus and his grace that is the basis for our relationship with him. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. Faith in Christ is at the very core of who we are as Christians. But God knows that we are human beings. He knows we have feelings and we have ups and we have downs and in our lives. And sometimes it causes us to get discouraged and even depressed. Doubts can creep in and begin to erode our faith. Things can happen that cause us to question God and Jesus and his spirit. So he has added another motivation to keep us going. Another reason to be the men and women he wants us to be. Another reason to do what he wants us to do. You see, when he created us with the capacity to remember. We remember events, relationships, good times, bad times. When it comes to faith, often these memories help us confirm our faith. When I doubt my relationship with Jesus, I can look back at the time I made a specific decision to follow him. When I begin to wonder where God is, I can remember the time that Jesus physically healed me. When I begin to question God, I can think back to the time he specifically broke into my life with a miracle that could not be explained by coincidence. Memories are powerful, and if we will every so often stop and remember all the things God has done for us, it can be a powerful tool to help us deal with whatever we're trying to deal with here today. But even with those incredible memories, there are still times when I begin to wonder, did those things really happen? Did I really make that choice? Did God really show up then? Once in a while, the clarity of those events begins to fade, and as those memories fade, we may begin to question, why am I spending all this time volunteering at Westgate, or that neighborhood church, or the pregnancy center? Why should I be so concerned about what's happening halfway around the world where there are international workers? Why should I care about the life of my neighbor? So what do I do when these feelings begin to take over my attitudes and my actions? What do I do when I start feeling discouraged? How do I deal with my doubts that seem to be pushing my faith to the limit? That's where hope comes in. Not only do we have the capacity to look back at what God has done for us, we also have the capacity to look forward to see what he has promised us. So Paul tells us that not only is our faith a motivation to do what we do, but so also is hope. The love you have for this all the saints comes because of the hope that has been laid up for us in heaven. Let's see what that's all about. The term has been laid up for refers to something that has already been done. It's past tense. It's already been accomplished. There's something that has already there in heaven waiting for us. Well, what is it? Well, Paul doesn't tell us until verse 12, and this is what he says. Giving thanks to God the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Well, what is that inheritance? Well, he continues in verses 13 and 14. The inheritance is he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and the forgiveness of sin. The inheritance is a new kingdom. We have been taken out of the domain of darkness and transferred us to a new kingdom. It is Jesus' kingdom. You remember just before Jesus was crucified, he's standing before Pontius Pilate, and Jesus asked him if he was a king. He said, "That's what you say." Then he said, "But my kingdom is not of this world." And praise God, it's not, because this world is one of darkness and despair. But we've been transferred into a new kingdom, which is nothing like the one we live in now. It's nothing like what we with what we have to deal with now. It is a kingdom led by Jesus Christ. The person who loved us enough to die for us is now our king. He has redeemed us, or literally bought us, out of the kingdom of this earth and its problems and its pain, and has put us into his kingdom. And I think we can praise God for that. But then why are we still here? Why are we still subject to pain and problems? If we've been bought out of this world, then why are we still in it? Well, that question comes, I'm sorry to say, when we put ourselves in the center of the universe. It comes when I feel as though my well-being, my comfort, and my satisfaction are the most important things there are to live for. At the beginning, Paul explained to us that we are all saints, and I want to go back to that. We are set apart and we belong to him. He bought us with his own life, and as such, we are subject to him. We have made that decision to be subject to him. And while he certainly could have put us in a heavenly kingdom the minute we were born again, he didn't. Instead, he left us here in this mess. And he left us in this mess because he didn't just save us for our own benefit, but for the benefit of the whole world. He has us here to be light in a dark world. We are reconciled to him so that we might serve him. There is a world that desperately needs to hear the good news of Jesus. And God has left us here on this planet so that we can tell them about it. And that's why Paul tells us about the hope we have in Jesus. One day, we will be presented to the Father, totally forgiven. All the mess we've been through, all the sinful things we've done to ourselves and to others, all the suffering we have gone through will be over. The Apostle John told us there will be no more sadness, no more tears, no more pain, no more suffering. That is the hope we are anticipating. That is the hope he has promised us. It is the hope that Jesus bought for us when he gave up his life for us. That is good news. That is the gospel. That is what he has laid up for us in heaven. But in the meantime, our job is to let the rest of the world know about it. In faith, we can look back and remember what Jesus has done for us. And with hope, we can look forward to what Jesus has prepared for us. What a Savior we have. So Paul wants to commend us for our faith, our faithfulness, and our hope in Jesus Christ. And that leads us to our final section of this text. Paul not only commends us, he also has some things he wants us to grow in, and so he prays for us. And this is what he prays. We have not ceased to pray for you and ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. One of the biggest arguments unbelievers throw at us is that we don't use our brains. They see our faith is rooted in emotion and ancient man-made myths. Paul understood this even back in his day, and so he starts praying that we will be filled with the knowledge of God's will. He begins with knowing something, and that something is an understanding of why we believe what we believe. Now, we can't know everything about God and his will because he is infinite and we are not, but we can know enough to understand who he is and many of the reasons why he does what he does. This is why Pastor Rob invited Dr. Brent Strasberg for a weekend back in June and then followed up with that series on asking for a friend. Just like Paul, Rob wants us to have a reason for our belief in Jesus Christ. In spite of what the critics of Christianity say, faith in Jesus Christ is reasonable. Jesus' life makes sense. What he did in his teaching and then in his death and resurrection makes sense. It is logical to believe in Jesus Christ. So Paul starts off with wanting us to be filled with the knowledge of God's will. That's knowing as best we can with our finite minds, knowing not only what God wants us to be and do, but also some of the reasons why he wants us to do them. He wants us filled with the knowledge, not just an inkling, but a fullness of what God's will is. But that's not all, and this is where it gets really interesting. Paul doesn't stop with the knowledge of God's will. He adds, in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Knowledge is where it starts, but it doesn't end there. There are people in our world today who have an incredible knowledge of God. They know the Bible backwards and forwards. They understand all kinds of theological doctrine and theory. But for some reason, they look at the Bible as just a history book. They have an incredible knowledge about God, but they don't actually know God. This is the same as what a super fan of some celebrity might have. He or she knows everything about a particular star. They know when they were born, where they were born, what their favorite color is, their favorite food, what kind of car they drive. They know where they live and who they love. But they have never actually met the person. The closest they ever got was Section 4, Row D, Seat 6. There is no real relationship. There is not a relational connection on any level. Paul wants us to know for certain that God's will is not like that. It's not just what we know about God, but it's a relationship with God. That relationship happens through His Spirit. There has to be a deeper connection than just knowledge. We need to connect with God spiritually, and that is where relationship takes place. That's why Paul uses the term spiritual wisdom and understanding. We connect with God spiritually. And that really is good news. God wants us to have a relationship with us. God wants to have a relationship with us. And not only that, He has provided the way to do it. As I said before, our faith is in a person, Jesus Christ, who is not physically with us. So God gave us His Spirit to live in us and connect with us through our own spirit. And what's so incredible about this is the spiritual relationship is not restricted by our physical limitations. Our spiritual relationship to Jesus is not limited by time and space. I can speak with Jesus anytime I want to, any place I want to. I've often thought I would like to have been here when Jesus was here, to actually meet Him in person. But in reality, when Jesus left this planet and gave us His Spirit, He actually expanded our capacity for relationship with Him. I don't need to go to Galilee in the year 30 AD to speak with Jesus. I can talk with Him right here, right now. As important as the knowledge of His will is, it is the spiritual wisdom and understanding that comes with our spiritual relationship with Him that's most important. Now, why is it so important? Well, let's keep reading. Paul is praying that you may walk in a manner worthy of the Lord to please Him in all respects. What does it mean to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord? Well, he tells us it means to please Him in all respects. Well, what does that mean? Well, I want you to take a moment. We're going to take about 10 seconds and ask yourself, not out loud, but ask yourself this question. What does it mean to please God in all respects? You got 10 seconds. Think of it. What does it mean to please God in all respects? I am guessing that most of us, myself included, maybe among other things, but one of the things we thought about was pleasing God means obedience and good behavior, right? What pleases God is good behavior. And it's natural to think that way. We have been taught that since we were little kids. Be a good boy, be a good little girl. Being good, behaving appropriately, was what pleased our parents. And besides that, every single religion in the world teaches its followers to be good, to do good things. But there is something else that transcends our obedience and our behavior. And the word transcends is just a big word that means goes beyond or is greater than. While obedience and behavior are important, there is something that goes beyond those things. There is something that is greater than obedience and behavior as we walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. Now, in Jesus and Paul's time in Palestine, the first century, there was a group of religious leaders called the Pharisees who strongly, they really influenced the religious climate of Israel at that time. And they felt it was their job to make sure that the Jews were keeping all 613 laws of the Torah. And so they tried to create something that would transcend the law, something greater than the law, that would make it easier to keep the Torah. So what they did was they made more laws. These extra laws, or what they called traditions of the elders, were designed so that if you kept them, you'd automatically keep all the laws of the Torah. I'll give you an example. The Torah teaches not to cook a baby goat in its mother's milk. So the Pharisees created a law that if you kept it, would guarantee that you couldn't possibly cook a baby goat in its mother's milk. They created a new law that said this: you must have two sets of cooking utensils, one for milk and dairy, and one for everything else. That way, if you used your utensils the way you should, there would be virtually no chance of breaking the Torah. Not even one drop of milk could get on a baby goat. In fact, kosher kitchens are still doing that today. And they did this for many of the laws of the Torah. Did it work? Of course it didn't work. You can't make people keep the rules by giving them more rules. All that does is make being good even harder. And we've done that in our own churches. When I was growing up, don't play cards, don't smoke, don't chew, don't drink, don't go to movies. We've added all kinds of rules. All that does is make being good even harder. In fact, one of Jesus' main criticisms of the Pharisees was that in some cases, the traditions of the elders made it impossible to please God. So then, if it's not keeping of the rules that makes it possible to please God, then what does? What is it that transcends obedience, law-keeping, and rule-following? What is it that gives God the most pleasure? What God wants from us is our hearts. It's our relationship with Him that pleases Him most. Even in the Old Testament, there were times when God chastised the Jews for making the sacrifices that were part of the law that He gave them. But He chastised them, and the reason He chastised them is because their heart wasn't in it. It was just a ritual and nothing more. As you read the Old Testament and the New Testament, you'll see a lot about how we should live our lives. There's a lot of rules, a lot of things we should do, but what you'll see more than anything else is God calling us into a relationship with Him first and foremost. Westgate Chapel, if you remember nothing else from all the sermons you've heard from this pulpit, remember this: God is calling you into a relationship with Him. Everything else in a believer's life flows from that relationship. Listen to how Paul continues his prayer: to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work. Paul talked to us about our faith, which looks back to what Jesus did for us on the cross and what He's done for us in our own personal lives. Then he talked about hope, which looks forward to the future of what He has already promised to give us when we get to heaven. But what are we supposed to do now? This verse is clear. We are to bear fruit in every good work. Well, what fruit is he talking about? Well, it could be, and probably is referring to several different things, but one thing for sure he's referring to is the fruit of the Spirit. I mentioned the fruit of the Spirit earlier, and I want to go back to it again, only in a little bit more depth. Galatians 5:22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. 9 things altogether. And it's something I found very interesting, especially in relationship to what we're talking about today. What I found interesting is that all 9 of these characteristics are characteristics of a person who is good at relationships. Love. Love is the essential characteristic of a Christ-like relationship. Joy. Who doesn't like to be around a person full of joy, a person who is not complaining, but who just loves life? Peace. There are so few actual peacemakers in the world, those who can help other people learn to get along with each other. Patience. So many broken people need someone with patience who can love them in spite of their difficult personalities, in spite of their quirks and their problems. Kindness. I don't think kindness needs any explanation. I think we all understand what it's all about. Goodness. A good person is one who can be trusted. There's no deception in a good person. Faithfulness. A faithful person will not let you down, and they will be honest with you. Gentleness. We're so quick to be defensive, so quick to lash out, so quick to fight back. A gentle person does none of these things. Self-control. How many relationships have been lost because of a lack of self-control? On the flip side, how many relationships have been saved because someone held their tongue or even their fist? The fruit of the Spirit are the characteristics of a person who is good at relationships. They're also the characteristics of a person whose life is pleasing to God. They are the characteristics of a person walking in a manner worthy of the Lord. They're not things that we can conjure up ourselves. They're not things that if they are missing, we can will ourselves to do. They are instilled in us by the Spirit of God. They are the fruit of the Spirit of God living in us. When we give our lives to Jesus, He will immediately begin to grow that fruit in us. As we grow in our relationship with Him, the fruit will become more and more evident. So what is it that transcends the Torah? What is it that transcends the laws and the rules we find in the Bible? What is it that transcends our obedience and our behavior? It is the Holy Spirit himself and the relationship that he is creating in you. Everything else in our lives flows from that relationship. When that relationship is strong, everything else in Westgate Chapel's life will be too. In faith, we look back at what Jesus has done for us. With hope, we look forward to what Jesus has promised us. Today, we walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, allowing the Spirit to control us and express the fruit of the Spirit in us. That is what Paul is praying for Westgate Chapel, and that is what he is praying for you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you have provided us with your Holy Spirit, and that your Spirit lives not near us, not around us, but in us. And I pray, Lord, that every single person in Westgate Chapel will allow your Spirit to control their lives, that they will express the fruit of the Spirit in their lives. I pray, Lord, that they will love each other, they will care for each other, and that everybody who comes in this building will see it and realize it, and it will be something that draws them in. I pray that as we go out into our neighborhoods, the same thing will happen. They will see the love of Jesus Christ expressed, not because we're trying to do it, but because you are working through us for it. And I pray these things in the name of our fantastic Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
God is good. Amen. Amen. Well, church family, yeah, you may be seated just for a moment. Again, I want to thank you for worshiping with us today. And at the close of our service, again, our prayer room will be open for those who have prayer needs this morning just outside these doors and to the right. We have our prayer team that would love the opportunity to meet and pray with you as you leave. You can give your tithes and offerings if you brought those with you at the buckets that are at the back of the doors. But before we close, we want to take just a minute again to say thank you to Glenn and Sheila. Please. It has been about 12 years here that you guys have been with us. You beat Rochelle and I here by just a few weeks. And so I have had the privilege and we have had the privilege of serving with you all these years. I'm not getting emotional yet. But one of the things I recognize is that there are many people in this room who have walked this journey with you guys over the past 12 years. There are some, though, that maybe have only known you for a few of those years, 1 year, maybe even just a few months. And so we wanted to take just a little moment to share a little bit of your lives with everyone here and your journey in ministry with the Lord. Give everyone a quick snapshot just to let you know how Glenn and Sheila have served in ministry over the years. They began began together at Portsmouth Alliance Church in Portsmouth, Virginia, where Glenn was an assistant pastor and youth pastor at the church there. Served there for 3 years until 1980 and 1988, where they began their ministry serving with the Christian Missionary Alliance overseas as international workers. And during that time, they went to Thailand and worked with the local churches there. Following their time there in 1988, they moved on to Malaysia and were in Malaysia until 1997, where they were dorm parents and also worked as the resident assistants at Dalat School. Then in 1997 to 2009, you moved to Black Forest Academy, Black Forest, Germany, and worked at Black Forest Academy there, again as dorm parents and also the resident director, spending your time caring for the students and kids of international workers. And then in 2009, the blessing of coming here and serving at Westgate Chapel with us. And it has been a great, great time of ministering together. You've served as our community life pastor, Glenn, overseeing everything from small groups to men's and women's ministry, deacons, deaconesses. You have practically, without the title, run the church in many ways. You have served as our care pastor. Yeah, you have served as our care pastor, faithfully caring for so many people in this church, helping to get started our Westgate Cares ministry. And as well, Sheila, you have served all along this road with Glenn so faithfully, teaching Bible studies, being involved in missions here at the church, and in many ways that people never see, the way you have faithfully served and used your gifts of hospitality to love on people here within this church. But in light of that, that's kind of like giving you guys a resume. There's so much more to Glenn, especially, that we have learned and seen over the years. And I thought I might share a couple of those. He knows what's coming. There's a few special things that I want to let you in on. Create some stories and things to talk about at our celebration after the service. The first thing you'll see this picture is that we did not know until Glenn got here that he was also a famous musician in his life. That's Glenn on the left there. He looks like one of the Beach Boys group. I know we would have had him audition and play on the platform and everything, but I mean, we know this about Glenn because, again, you will hear anytime you see Glenn walking the halls of Westgate Chapel, this man is singing a song, and it is phenomenal. Another thing that we didn't know, unless you're walking the halls of Westgate, you wouldn't see this, he often moonlights as a pirate. Look at that. I mean, this guy is a man of many different identities, and we have learned this well over the past many years. One thing I didn't know until I did a deep dive into the special archives of Facebook is that Glenn is actually an extreme sports enthusiast. That is Glenn. Is that Thailand? Am I correct where you did that? Bungee jumping in Thailand. Woo! I look at this picture, I have so many questions, Glenn, so many questions. Okay, not only that, Glenn and Sheila are grandparents, and we know that they love their grandkids, but what we didn't know is that he also doubles as a Jedi Knight. You'll see that here in this picture with his grandkid. And then the next thing is they are also world-famous movie stars, and look at that. Now, I will confess, Sheila, when I saw this picture, I'm like, who's the woman there with Glenn? That hair is gorgeous. I love that. Now, we have learned this truth with Glenn and Sheila over the last years because Glenn has actually been involved in so many productions here. You'll see this one where we had a fun time filming a golf video for a fundraiser that we did with Brian Harbauer and Pastor Larry. But there is one that is my all-time favorite. We did a series entitled Identity Theft, talking about the fruit of the Spirit nonetheless, and we thought we would show you Glenn in his finest moments.
The credit card I found on the ground was a gift from God. Can you believe I got a prom dress for only like $850? It fits so good, it shows off my killer cheerleading abs. What do I care? I don't have to pay for any of it.
So he never saw me behind him at that last walleye game when his credit card fell out of his pocket. Oh my gosh, I had the best time at the mall. Getting ready for the vacation I'm taking right now to Cancun. Swimsuits, shoes, purses, everything I needed. After I'm getting my nails done, I'm hitting the tanning salon.
You know, once I got his account number, I couldn't spend fast enough. New York, here I come. And that's not the best part. Next day, I'm going to see the hottest plastic surgeon in the city. Bikini season's coming. Gotta get a little lipo to take care of these saddlebags. We sure showed them. This is the life, hey girls?
Some of his finest work, Glenn. That was great. When we asked him to jump in that pool, it was freezing cold. We thought he was going to kill us when he got out. But let me tell you, we have had a ton of fun over the years. But most importantly, you guys have impacted our lives in so many different ways. Many times they're ways that people have seen, but oftentimes they're things that go unnoticed and that have been done behind the scenes. And the way that you guys have been faithful servants who consistently show the love of Christ to everybody that you come into contact with. I asked Chris if she would pull up this slide from your sermon where you talked to us this morning about how we are to be as followers of Jesus Christ who display the fruit of the Spirit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And Glenn, I mean it from the bottom of my heart. When you read that list in the first service this morning, I was amazed of just how descriptive it was of you guys and your ministry. What you have truly done is allowed yourselves to be the vessels of the Lord in the way that you love us as a church family, and we cannot thank you enough for that. And so, church family, this morning we have taken some time to create just a couple of videos. One video from your staff, just to again say thank you for all that you are and that you mean to us. And as well, one special message from President John Stumbo of the Christian Missionary Alliance. Let's watch those now.
Glenn,
who am I going to talk to about how terrible the pizza in Ohio is? You are kind of my Jersey connection, understanding the bagels, the pizza of the East Coast, the way of the East Coast. Ohio people, you're great, but just not quite like the East Coast.
One thing I will always remember is I can usually hear Glenn coming before I can see him, usually humming some classic tune.
Anytime I couldn't think of a song, I could hum a couple bars and you could give me the answer.
There's so much we can say about working with Glenn.
I am not particularly excited about why I'm making this video right now because I'm sad that you're leaving.
Some words that come to mind when I think about Glenn are genuine, kind, God-loving, nice beard.
Three words I would use to describe Glenn are caring, godly, and super easygoing.
When I think of Glenn, I think of love, joy, peace, kindness, the fruits of the Spirit and how present they are in your life.
Your caring heart for others and your smile and the heart that you have for this ministry here at Westgate. His heart is huge. He loves people in such a genuine way and you can see Jesus all over him in everything that he does.
He notices people and their efforts and their hard work.
I really appreciate when you stop by and say, hello, how are you? Because I feel like you're so genuine and you have a calming effect about you.
You have always been one of the kindest, most sincere people I've ever known.
You are kind and courteous and extremely intentional. You make anyone and everyone that sits with you just feel like the most important person, and I admire that about you.
How faithful you were to come alongside with me as we journeyed through men's fraternity years 1, 2, and 3, and then through my MSP program, and how you were my coach.
He has a special way about always taking his heart with him into every space that he's a part of, whether it's a meeting, whether it's caring for somebody from the church, whether it's preaching the word, he's always got his heart with him, and I love that.
Something that I always appreciated about you, Glenn, is that you ask caring and intentional questions. And I remember after one meeting, I had said something and you came up and talked to me about it, and you just related so well to me, and just those small moments of conversation just really meant more to me than you might have noticed.
Not just listen because you're a pastor, but you listen because you care. And so I'm going to miss that. I'm going to miss our conversations as I walk into your office and bug you.
Instantly, as I come into your office, just feeling a sense of goodness. It's okay. I was reflecting about you and our friendship and just how kind you are.
I want you to know that one of the things that I'm most thankful for and that I've really learned from you over the years is just the way that you have carried yourself with an incredible amount of humility and the way that you care for everybody that comes into your life. You show a great deal of compassion. You give people value and worth in the way that you work with them. And it's one of the things that I'm going to take away. And just you have really taught me about what it means to be Jesus to people that we minister to. So thank you. Thank you for the incredible amount of time and hours that you have poured into this church and to the people that worship here. And we're excited to see what God is going to continue to do through you and Sheila in the years to come.
How about if we give Glenn a new name in this next venture of his life? And I thought we would dub you Sir Glenn the Kind-Hearted.
Pastor Glenn, I want to add my voice to the many from the Westgate community and from the entire Christian Missionary Alliance who are wanting to come alongside at this moment and celebrate the call of God that came upon your life years ago and how you and your wife have lived that out. Circling the globe from Thailand to Toledo, impacting lives all across the way, leaving a legacy of blessing, and now you're transitioning. It's not an end of that call, but it is a new expression of it. And on behalf of the Christian Missionary Alliance, we just want to celebrate this moment. Thank you for how you have fulfilled the call of God that came upon your life day after day. And we want to release you into the wind of the Spirit for where He has you to go and to whom He has you to work with next. So I wish I could be there in person, but please receive this word as our way of saying you're known, you're loved, you're valued, you're appreciated, and we can't wait to hear what God continues to do in and through you. And I've been asked to pray at this moment. Father, we ask in Jesus' name that Pastor Glenn would feel a sense of the affirmation of the word and work of God in his own life, and that as there is transition and as there are goodbyes and hellos to come, that he would have a sweet sense that he continues to walk with you and be commissioned by you for all that you have for him to do and accomplish in this world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I'd like to ask at this time if our staff and elders that are here in the room would come up and join us on the platform, if you guys would come now. And we want to take a moment as a church family to pray over Glenn and Sheila as they move into this next stage. If I can have you guys come right on up here. And congregation, if you would please stand with us as we pray together. We are blessed to have Pastor Larry back with us this morning, and he's going to begin with praying, and then also our shepherding elder, Vice Chairman Chad Suon.
Father, you tell us in your word that you are the giver of every good gift. And one of the good gifts you have brought into our lives is the gift of knowing and serving alongside Glenn and Sheila. We thank you that they have followed you wherever you have led them over the years, from the U.S. to Thailand to Malaysia to Germany and back here to the U.S., and we thank you for leading them here. We praise you for all you have done in their lives and done in our lives. We thank you that we have learned not just from what they've said and taught, but from the way they have lived. We have seen in them Jesus Christ. In their humble hearts, in their servant spirits, and in their Christ-like example. We pray, Lord, that you would bless them and pour out on them your spirit for this next stage in their life. They have been faithful to you, and they are now stepping into a new place of ministry and life. And we pray that you will fill them fresh for this new stage. And we pray that you will fill them in such a way that pours over into the lives of others who don't yet know you. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. We thank you for your blessings in their lives. And we pray that as they move to meet new neighbors and new friends, that those people will be as blessed as much as we have been in getting to know them. And we know that you are not going to be any less faithful, any less loving, or any less supportive of them in their new home than you have been in every place where they have served you so far. We pray, Lord, that you will bless them mightily, that your Spirit would rest in them and pour out through them rivers of living water that will touch the people around them. We pray that you will bring glory to yourself, that this will go on until we all meet together again in your presence, where we'll never be separated again, and that's something we'll be very thankful for. May they bring you glory and praise until that day. We ask this all in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, and we ask it that they may bring glory and praise to you, everlasting glory. Amen.
Father, just give you thanks for Glenn and Sheila and just the way that they've been such examples of Jesus to us, Lord. Thank you for the service they've done here at Westgate. And I was struck by just thinking through of kind of the history that you've brought them through, from youth pastor to Thailand to dorm parents to dorm directors and then back to Westgate, Lord, and just all in preparation of what's next. And so I just really pray over that, Lord. I pray that as they move forward into this next venture that you have for them, that you would help them in the selling of their house and transitioning into their new place, and just reflecting on the things that they've done in each of our lives. And I was thinking too just about how Glenn was one of the first people we met when we came here, and just struck by his friendliness and warm welcome. And I was thinking too of just a meeting that I was in with him where I had first learned about listening prayer. And God, there's just been so many things over the years that have been learned from Glenn, and just the humility he shares. And God, I just pray that you would have great things planned for them here in this next phase. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you again thank Glenn and Sheila for their years of ministry here with us? And as you do, we got you guys just a couple of small gifts that we would like to give you. I'm going to let you hold this box here for me. Grab that. And we got you this just as a way to remember us. I was going to put a picture of myself in it, but, you know, I thought that might be not be the way to go. So we'll let you put the picture in. But, again, it's a beautiful picture frame and clock. And it reads here on the inscription, Glenn and Sheila Lewis, thank you for your 12 years of faithful service to the Lord through Westgate Chapel and 45 years of service through the CNMA. You have blessed all of our lives beyond measure. With love, your Westgate Chapel family. And we want to give this to you guys as a special memory as well. We have this gift from the elders, and as just a small token to say how much as a church family we have been blessed by you. And we recognize that all glory and honor goes to Jesus Christ, because what we have experienced through your ministry truly is his love. So thank you again. Would you thank Glenn and Sheila? As we close our service, again, I remind you that we have just a special time prepared over in the gymnasium here off to my left and your right. We would love for you to join us. You can take pictures and write special notes, but especially be sure to come by and give them a hug and tell them how much they have meant to you. Church family, it has been a blessing to worship together this morning. May we go out faithfully serving the Lord. We look forward to seeing you again next week. God bless you. Have a great week.